Hello, I'm Dr. Marla Shapiro, and I am a past president of the North American Menopause Society. And today I am so thrilled to be joined by Dawn Muslim. Dr. Dawn Muslim is a board certified lifestyle medicine breast specialist at the Robert and Monica Jacoby Center for Breast Health. She's a consultant in the Division of Hematology Oncology at Mayo, an assistant professor of medicine, and she serves as medical director for Mayo Clinic Florida Humanities in Medicine in Jacksonville, Florida. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you, Dr. Shapiro, for having me. Excited to be here.
So let's talk about breast cancer and lifestyle, because there's been so much lately in the media. I've got women in my practice coming to me saying, I can't have more than two glasses of wine a week. And all this concern about lifestyle and impact. And a lot of it is absolutely real and can make a difference. And I'm hoping that you can put this into perspective in terms of perhaps maybe the percentage of breast cancer that can be impacted, not necessarily prevented, but impacted through breast cancer, through lifestyle.
That's a great question. And this is pretty powerful wording. 33% of breast cancers can actually be prevented, we believe, if women lived healthier lifestyles. What's even more interesting is there's some expert reports that actually estimate that if this lifestyle change occurred when we were young, especially nowadays, you know, we're seeing our young children are eating a lot of ultra-processed foods, they're inactive, they're just not living these healthy lifestyles. But projections suggest that maybe we can reduce and modify that risk by as high as 50 to 70%, which is
wow.
Just so there's many lifestyle elements that are important when it comes to breast cancer and its occurrence.
So let's talk about what some of those are. And also, you know, is it ever too late to make some of these changes? I mean, I hear you when we say younger is better. That's true for most things. But, you know, when along the continuum can we make changes and what changes should we be making?
Yeah, great question. And, you know, we know that the American Cancer Society estimated that among postmenopausal women, there was a 30% reduction in breast cancer risk if postmenopausal women lived healthier. So it's never too late to make these changes. And we saw this in a 2020 weight loss study where postmenopausal women that were successful with weight loss had a reduction in breast cancer risk. So great question, but you know, whether you are trying to prevent breast cancer, whether you've been diagnosed with breast cancer, starting to live healthy today matters to make that change. And not only do you reduce your risk of breast cancer, all of the things that matter for reducing breast cancer are also the same exact things that are good for your heart. And we know that's the number one cause of death in women. So it's really important for overall
health. And I'm going to throw in your brain, because women worry about dementia. So all of this is good for your brain as well. So when you talk about, you know, nutritional approach and a healthy lifestyle, put that into some examples that are concrete for us that we can counsel our patients about.
You know, the number one reason women come to see me is nutrition. You know, so we know that plant predominant nutrition really, really matters. And, you know, what does that mean? Number one, the whole food aspect of a whole food plant-based diet is what matters most, is getting rid of those processed foods. That's really where people need to start. And we know that within our children now, their diet is about 67% of ultra-processed food, as is adults. So we really need to reduce that risk. And we know that ultra-processed food consumption is linked to increased premature mortality. But in addition, the kind of diet that we really want to communicate to people is more of a plant slant or a plant-forward diet. It doesn't need to be plant only. That would be great, but very few people are able to accommodate that. So a plant-forward diet, plant foods are the only foods that have fiber. And we know that there was another great study that showed that fiber consumption, those that had more versus those that had less, had an 8% reduced risk of breast cancer. And would you believe that 97% of Americans are fiber deficient?
Oh, I do believe that.
Yes, so animal products have zero fiber. Plant products are where we get our fiber, so our whole grains. And you know, everyone comes in oftentimes to see me and they say, oh, I'm on a low carb diet. I'm like, oh, I don't want you on a low carb diet. You know, carbohydrates are great for you, but it needs to be the right carbohydrates. So it needs to be whole grain carbohydrates that are rich in fiber, not processed carbohydrates or refined carbohydrates. Vegetables and fruits are great. Same thing. Women oftentimes avoid fruit because they're scared of sugar. And we know that whole fruit is great for you. Fruit juice, however, has been linked to an increased risk of cancer. So we want to avoid fruit juice. Again, you're pulling away the fiber in fruit juice. We want to eat the whole fruit. Nuts and seeds are also seen to be very healthy. And then, of course, beans, which are an amazing option that's very inexpensive to replace that animal-based protein, and beans are going to give you protein as well as fiber. So it's terrific for you. And so then, you know, aside from that healthy dietary pattern, we would really want women to limit their alcohol consumption. Alcohol is a class one carcinogen. So, you know, as physicians, if someone says, well, doctor, you know, what do I do about alcohol? It's kind of the same conversation we have with our patients about cigarettes. And it's really kind of a personal preference how you approach your patients, but we aren't telling patients you can smoke cigarettes in moderation. So I personally have a bit of a challenging time when it comes to the language of we can be moderate with our alcohol consumption. But when it comes to breast cancer, we know that alcohol increases the risk of both, and this is scary, it increases the risk of premenopausal breast cancer. That means when women drink young, it can actually increase the risk of breast cancer occurring when they're young. That really bothers me because, you know, we haven't been on Earth long enough for breast cancer really to occur in these young women.
Right.
Number one and two risk factors for breast cancer is being a woman and getting older. So things that can push that forward, like alcohol at a young age, extremely concerning. And we know that alcohol has become so accepted and normalized in society. But it is a dose-dependent risk. So we know that the recommendation is to have no more than one standard drink a day. And so that also has to be communicated. So that's 5 ounces of wine. No one does 5 ounces.
Yeah, but we now have the World Health Organization and a fairly large meta-analysis that's even said more than 2 glasses of 5 ounces a week is associated with increased risk. And that for many women is shocking because alcohol has become, you know, part of our normative culture without necessarily thinking about the fact that alcohol is in fact a carcinogen.
That's exactly correct. And you're right. Canada just came out with their new guidelines that men and women, new drinks. I love this. I mean, this is really proactive. They're taking a stance because they know this is going to reduce their healthcare expenditure if they correct this. You know, alcohol is also an addictive substance. It causes depression. We have an enormous mental illness issue. And then it causes obesity. It contributes to weight gain. So there's so many reasons to avoid alcohol. But from a breast cancer risk reduction standpoint, we know that in the United States, current recommendations are limit the alcohol consumption to less than one standard drink a day. But I really talk towards trying to avoid alcohol, really reducing women to be mindful of that. The World Heart Federation took a stance last year and said, hey, there's no health benefit for your heart when it comes to alcohol.
And that's, I think that's important because for many years we talk about the Mediterranean diet as being a very important diet where alcohol is part of that diet. So leaving alcohol alone for a moment, let's move on to another area that many people are confused about, soy. Where do we stand with soy?
Soy is fabulous. It's a great way, again, to replace animal-based proteins. The soy myth came many decades ago when there was soy research that was done in rodents, and they gave these rodents a whole bunch of soy, and it caused mammary tumorigenesis. But rodents do not metabolize soy the same way humans do. So we know with research from the American Cancer Society, from the American Institute for Cancer Research, that there are studies that show that if a woman consumes soy and then she's diagnosed with breast cancer later in life, she has a reduced risk from dying from breast cancer. There are very few things that can modify survival after a breast cancer diagnosis, but soy consumption before a breast cancer diagnosis does that. There's also suggestion that just reduces the risk of breast cancer altogether. It doesn't bind tightly to the estrogen receptor alpha. Estrogen receptor alpha is where the proliferation occurs in the breast, and soy doesn't bind tightly there. Instead, soy binds tightly to estrogen receptor beta. And estrogen receptor beta, that's an anti-proliferative signaling. So very, very wonderful in terms of overall breast health. We believe the key time to consume soy is when you're an adolescent, when you're having thearchy and breast development. So, you know, it is to be encouraged for our young girls to have whole soy. Think of things like edamame, which would be the soy beans. You know, it's mildly processed if you think of things like tofu and soy milk, but that's still going to be very healthy. Tempeh, miso, but soy is a wonderful option. There is no risk. If you're a breast cancer survivor, there is also survivorship benefits. The American Cancer Society last year did a beautiful meta-analysis that showed among breast cancer survivors that had the most versus those that had the least amount of soy, 25% reduced risk of breast cancer recurrence. And this is a statistically significant finding. Yeah. So this is incredibly exciting. American Cancer Society says, women, if you've had breast cancer that's estrogen receptor positive, it's safe for you to have soy. So that's a big myth that has got to get out to the overall healthcare population so we can inform our patients properly.
Okay, so we've talked about alcohol and whole plants. We've talked about soy. Vitamins and supplements, that's another big area of confusion when it comes to reducing breast cancer risk.
Yeah, I mean, bottom line, there is no magic bullet. You know, we have even seen in study after study that if you optimize vitamin D with a pill, it still doesn't reduce the risk of breast cancer occurring. There's a little bit of a different finding in survivorship studies, but when we're talking about actually preventing cancer from occurring, no pill. You got to live the healthy lifestyle. You got to maintain your weight. You got to move your body. You got to eat a healthy diet, and you have to try to avoid those carcinogens that we're so tempted to have, like alcohol, right? So it's about eating that healthy, living that healthy lifestyle. And so I would say, all right, maybe we could say, well, what is the number one superfood you would recommend for patients? I'd say fiber.
Yes, I hear you. I hear you. So that's why plants are so important.
Yeah, no magic bullet. Patients come in to see me and they think I'm going to prescribe supplements. I'm like, no, we're going to stop supplements, especially because there could be harm in supplements. You know, we've seen harm with beta carotene supplementation. And in the SELECT trial, there was some harm with selenium and vitamin E supplementation. So I do not prescribe supplements to my patients unless there's a vitamin deficiency. If someone's on a plant-only diet, then there certainly is a role for vitamin B12 supplementation. We should be mindful of checking vitamin D. You know, so if someone is vitamin D deficient, you of course need to supplement.
Right.
If someone's iron deficient, any deficiencies, we supplement. But nonetheless.
I think your enthusiasm is so catching, and it's certainly going to alter the way I practice medicine and my counseling. And I think that for all of our healthcare practitioners listening, we're going to listen to this over and over again. Thank you so much for being with us today and really exciting us about the fact that we can make a change through diet and lifestyle. Those numbers are spectacular.
They sure are. Well, thank you, Dr. Shapiro, for having me.